Good evening. Hi, I'm Jack Rosenthal. I'm the interim director of Roosevelt House, the Public Policy Institute that Jennifer Rabb has developed for Hunter College. And this is the latest in a series of public programs on timely issues. As you may know, Sarah Delano Roosevelt built this house in 1908 as a wedding present for Franklin and Eleanor, and it was their New York City home until they moved to a somewhat grander house in Washington in 1933. 1933 year, that was the year, that year also marked a pivotal moment in the subject of our tonight's discussion. It was the era of Al Capone and Elliot Ness and the St. Valentine's Day Massacre, crime that caused such alarm that only a few months after FDR took office, Prohibition was repealed. President Hoover's Wickersham Commission had focused almost entirely on bootleg crime. It was not until 1966 that the Katzenbach Crime Commission connected the dots, showing that police, prosecutors, courts, and prisons are parts of what should be seen as a criminal justice system. Problems with this system are the subject of mounting concern. Mayor de Blasio made stop and frisk arrests a campaign issue, and minor marijuana busts are a live subject this week. State after state strains to hold down swelling prison costs. California struggles to end inhumane prison overcrowding. The New York Times documents the cruel abuse of young prisoners at Rikers Island. In the New Yorker last month, Jennifer Gonerman told the chilling story of a young man jailed for 3 years without even a hearing. Meanwhile, even as public concern rises, newspapers' ability to expose injustice is steadily declining. And that brings us to our guests tonight, the creators of a pioneering initiative to create high-quality investigative reporting about criminal justice online. The timing couldn't be better. The Marshall Project launches formally on Sunday. The founder and chairman is Neil Barsky, who started as a journalist at the Daily News and the Wall Street Journal, covering real estate and gambling. He mastered both fields so well that he was soon hired by Morgan Stanley. Within a year, Institutional Investor ranked him as an all-star analyst. Then Neil started a hedge fund that was exceptionally successful until he folded it in 2009. What would he do next? He returned, in a way, to journalism. You may have seen Koch, the documentary film about the former mayor. Neil didn't just finance it. He made it, and now he returns to full-throated journalism with the Marshall Project. The editor-in-chief is Bill Keller, the modern model of a foreign correspondent. New York Times readers followed his intense coverage of the breakup of the Soviet Union that won him the Pulitzer Prize in 1989. Colleagues still applaud his reporting on bloody Chechnya or about the disillusioned Soviet troops returning from Afghanistan. Later, he headed the Times Bureau in Johannesburg, covering the end of apartheid and the triumph of Nelson Mandela. Bill then became an editor and for 8 years, the editor of the Times, during which period the paper won 18 Pulitzer Prizes. Later, he wrote an op-ed column until joining Neil. Let's structure our conversation in three parts. First, let's discuss the Marshall Project specifically, then the criminal justice system, and finally, the evolution of online journalism generally. Neil, what is the Marshall Project? What forms does it take? A website? Daily postings? And which Marshall?
Well, I'll start with the last part of the question. Marshall is Thurgood Marshall, first African-American justice of the Supreme Court, as everybody knows. Also the chief counsel for the NAACP Legal Defense Fund in the 40s and 50s, and did pioneering legal work and argued Brown versus Board of Ed, as you may know. And we chose him as our sort of linchpin, I think, after not merely because of his record as a fierce advocate for civil rights and social justice as a Supreme Court justice, but I had read a book, which I recommend to everybody here, called Devil in the Grove, which is about a 1949 case in Lakeland, Florida, in which four African-American men were falsely accused of rape, and all the horrible things that happened in the wake of that accusation. The Legal Defense Fund, in the person of Thurgood Marshall, tried to argue and save these kids' lives. He largely failed, and I read it over the summer. I was already thinking about doing this, and it was just his own heroism and the great personal risk he took to get this done. But also what struck me was, if anyone reads this, it would be stunned that this was happening after World War II in our country. I mean, just I won't delineate everything that happened, but there was certainly no national press covering that trial. In fact, I had never heard of the trial. Well, I've never heard of the case before, and many of us hadn't. So for a combination of reasons, we chose to name it after Thurgood Marshall. What the Marshall Project is a legal entity that is a 501c3, that is dedicated to, it's a journalism organization dedicated to covering criminal justice. Then it's a jump ball. We can take it, and Bill can take it anywhere we want to go. But for the foreseeable future, we will be a newsroom of 25 people, writing mostly, and over time, hopefully, branch out in other forms of media about the criminal justice system. And I'd like Bill to talk a lot more about what our goals and aspirations are journalistically. But politically, and the real underlying motive for doing this was not merely to create a great journalism organization, which is itself has a great social value. But I know the real point of the Marshall Project is to tap into what is really a growing national discovery about the outrageousness of our criminal justice system. And it's broken, it's inhumane, it's expensive, it's racist. And we're doing something that I don't know that's been done, which is we're saying, we believe in the old verities of traditional journalism, honesty, truth-telling, nonpartisanship. But through this work, we hope to help spark a national conversation, help elevate the issue of criminal justice reform to one of national urgency. So there's a small leap between the two. We are nonpartisan. We won't take positions. You know Bill well enough to know that he takes the mandate of journalism very seriously, as do I. So that's what the Marshall Project is. That's what the name comes from. And as you said, we launch Sunday, and then it'll be an adventure.
Bill, your staff has already done some stellar reporting. Could you describe it, give some examples?
Yeah, we had, maybe just to lay the groundwork a little bit, our plan is to do a combination of large projects with an investigative edge to them. Obviously, you can't do one of those a day. They're special. We'll also do quicker reactions to news events as they happen. We may react by supplying context. We may react by inviting various parties to come in and argue about the meaning of events. So we will be both on the news and, I hope, writing stories that make the news. We've done two pieces that wouldn't hold until our launch for competitive reasons. The first one was the story of a man who was executed 10 years ago in Texas named Todd Willingham. He was convicted of deliberately setting the fire that killed his three daughters. it's a case that's been controversial really ever since it happened. His conviction rested on two pillars. One of them was forensic evidence that the fire was an arson, and the other was the testimony of a jailhouse snitch who said over and over again that Willingham had confessed to him in prison. The first pillar was largely demolished some years back by reporting mostly in the Chicago Tribune by a reporter named Maurice Posley, who came up with a number of forensics experts who said that the science had advanced since the time of Willingham's trial and that it was almost certainly an accident. Our accomplishment, I think, was to largely debunk the second pillar, the jailhouse snitch, who we reported had recanted and said that he had been reimbursed for his testimony by the prosecutor and a local kind of booster of the criminal justice establishment who gave him money and jobs and things like that. It was a freelance piece written by Maurice Posley, the same Maurice Posley who had exposed the earlier flaws in that case when he worked for the Chicago Tribune. The fact that he doesn't work for the Chicago Tribune anymore gets a little bit to the point that Neil touched on, that there aren't enough newspapers, news organizations right. doing this kind of reporting, including some that used to do it extremely well. The other piece that we've already published, we did with Slate, and it goes to a subject that I think we'll be returning to again and again, which is the term of art they use in the criminal justice world is the school-to-prison pipeline. It's taking things that once upon a time would have ended with a student being put in detention and turned them into criminal behavior. So this is a story of a young man who in West Virginia who was no angel, but basically he's got sucked at a very young age into the criminal justice system. And Dana Goldstein, who wrote the piece, used that case to illustrate the larger point.
Neil, you're aiming for high-quality journalism.
Not aiming, that's a given.
Who pays? Can you afford to pay quality journalism, and can a nonprofit model survive?
Mm-hmm. Let's keep me out of it for now. Can I afford to pay for non-quality journalism? that remains to be seen. I think the short answer is yes. There's evidence of it in other very high-quality journalism organizations like ProPublica and Center for Investigative Reporting. But I'll just speak to my experience to date. We did something that, pardon my French, some people say was a little ass backward. We announced what we were going to do. We announced our budget. We started hiring people, and then we went out to find the money. Usually you get an endowment, or you start small, and then you... But I had had enough meetings with foundations that I and individuals that I had a very strong sense that we'd get support. And the support is, yes. So the short answer is we're very heartened by where we are. We're about 60% committed for our first 2 years, which is a lot of, it's public. It's our goal is to raise $10 million in 2 years. And we've got commitments for a little over $6 million already. And we haven't really launched. And that's mostly large foundations with a large number of individuals and philanthropists. There's two issues. One is there a social good? Is there a civic good in supporting what has come to be known as accountability journalism? As Bill said, the Chicago Tribune used to be able to fund investigative reporting, and now it can't. And I think we could probably count on two hands, while there is a lot of journalism being done, and there are a lot of websites, and the social media has exploded, and the consumption of news has grown. The number of institutions that can afford to have a reporter spend 3 months on a story has been decimated, literally, by tenth, I suspect. So I think you can count on two hands who's doing that. Yeah. So the argument, there's a journalism argument, which is that there's a civic good, just like there's a civic good in having orchestras, which may, for all I know, were profitable in Vienna in the 19th century or 18th century. Today we require philanthropy to support our museums and our orchestras and our libraries. It may come to the certain kind of journalism requires public subsidy or subsidy. And I have to credit Dick Toefel at ProPublica, who's the president and a friend of ours, for helping me frame this because this is exactly his argument, and it's very effective. The other thing is criminal justice. And there's a growing, that's not a hard argument to make to many people who are incredibly mindful, increasingly mindful of just how, I just use the word broken over and over again, the system is, and how unfair it is, and how it doesn't really reflect on the country very well. So there's, I would say, there are support so far, probably half are people who are moved or motivated by the journalism mission, and then maybe half, or maybe a little more, by the criminal justice mission. It's a lot of work. I'm going to Chicago tomorrow, meeting with prospective funders of ours. It's most of what I'm doing. I don't mind. I think, you know, I'm meeting very interesting people. And I think when you believe in what you're doing, it's really not rough to do. Mm-hmm. But it's work. We're not done. And we hope to raise more than that, because there's infinite numbers of stories we can do and other forms of journalism we can execute. So I am cautiously optimistic that we'll get to where we have to go.
Bill, how does investigative journalism online differ from what the Times and other mainstream media do? What's happened to the passion for exclusives, for scoops?
Well, there's sort of two questions. I mean, the investigative journalism online doesn't differ appreciably from the kind of stuff we used to do at the New York Times. It's still very time-consuming, expensive to do. It requires often searches of records that are not readily available to the public. It involves cultivation of sources who aren't licensed to say what we want them to say and tell us what we want them to tell us. There are certain advantages to doing it online, aside from the whole cost factor. I mean, we don't have to buy paper and trucks to do it, but it's easier, thanks to the internet, to access far-flung records. The internet has proven to be a very useful tool in gathering the news. It's an invaluable tool in disseminating the news that you can share instantly with millions, literally millions of people. And it's an advantage in how you present the news. Our stories may read like New York Times or Washington Post stories, and in fact, the story that we're beginning with, are launching with, is two parts on Sunday and Monday, which will also be published in the Washington Post. But if you look at them online, it'll be a much different experience. The graphics, the layout, just the ease of absorbing the information, and the kind of appeal to multiple senses. It's very much a different experience from turning the ink on paper.
Stop for a minute on the point about the Washington Post, and you earlier mentioned Slate. Mm-hmm. The idea of cooperation is so different from the traditional journalistic view of scoops.
That's true. I would not say that our competitive DNA has been leached out of us. And one reason I'm not talking in any detail about exactly what we're publishing in the Washington Post is because I have a kind of proprietary competitive feeling about this story. I want it to come as a surprise, including to the papers that aren't publishing it. Mm-hmm.
Like one in particular that we used to work for.
One that I still love and read, but yes, I prefer that they read it in the Washington Post this time around. But it is true that the nature of competition has changed a lot. 10 years ago, the idea that the New York Times would have, or the Washington Post, taken journalism from somewhere else and published it freely, maybe not even exclusively, would have been hard to swallow. While I was executive editor, though, it was, and this is really when about the time that this notion of nonprofit journalism shared with the profit world began, we did a couple of collaborations with ProPublica, including a marvelous piece in the New York Times Magazine by Sherry Fink about the Memorial Hospital in New Orleans during Katrina, which won her and ProPublica and the New York Times the Pulitzer Prize.
And led to a terrific book.
And led to a terrific book, yes, it did.
Let's turn to the second part of the conversation and talk a bit about criminal justice. There are a lot of issues. Harsh and disparate sentencing, racial disparities, overcrowded prisons, the militarization of police, abuse of prosecutorial discretion. How do you decide on priorities for what to report about? And are you willing to tell us about what you've got coming up?
The answer to the second question is not in great detail.
Okay.
This is a startup not only in the financial sense that Neil has to answer for, it's a startup in the journalistic sense in that we, you know, normally you run a magazine, writers come in and they pitch you stories, you pick the ones you like and you run them. Or if you're running a newspaper, you have reporters who work for you, they cover beats, they go out and work their beats, they come in and they tell you what they've learned and they write it up and you react to news events. We literally started from nothing when we hired people. We didn't have, although we have had some people come in and pitch us freelance pieces and we've commissioned a few of them. But we're really just sort of starting from the interest that our reporters brought with them and then extrapolating from there. Over time, I think the main factors in deciding where to assign a reporter will be, do we think we can have real impact, and is it an area that somebody else is likely to be paying attention to? We'll be looking for targets of opportunity, places where we can add value to what's already being done.
Well, now, with respect to the militarization of police, mm-hmm. any day now, there either will or won't be an indictment coming out of the grand jury in Ferguson, Missouri. Do you prepare for that?
Funny you should ask.
We spent about half of the day talking about that because the expectation is that the grand jury will pronounce its verdict on Monday, and we have a couple of things in mind to respond to that. I mean, obviously, that it's going to be a major news story, and we don't want to replicate what is already being done very well. I mean, when we see, you know, for example, the New York Times sending reporters out to cover brutality at Rikers, our reaction is, thank God we don't have to write about Rikers. We can write about Cook County Jail or L.A. County Jail or some other hellhole because, you know, Rikers is being done well. And the same thing with Ferguson. You know, we're not going to try to repeat what the network television stations and the major newspapers will be doing. But we have some angles that I think will be a little different from what others have thought of.
Yeah, if I may, just as more of a witness to this, today is a great question because at about 11 o'clock, Bill sent his email to the full staff and basically said exactly what you said. Monday or coming up is this verdict. How do we do things differently? How do we approach this in a way that we can't will surprise people? And then we had a nice steady trickle all day long of reporters and some non-reporters opining and suggesting and bantering, and it was a real nice creative process. I don't know what we've decided, but it's, you know, there's another thing about most startups in journalism. They're not very well run. They make a lot of mistakes, and we'll make mistakes, and we'll retrofit. I'm not saying we won't. But I think, if I may, we're going to start with a level of professionalism that we're going to inherit, frankly, from our editor and reporters, that many some do, but many don't. And so I expect we'll learn and we'll change directions, but we expect day one to be excellent and professional. And so the way this whole Ferguson thing unfolded today is a great example of anticipating the news, doing it differently, not having what everybody else has, being consensus-driven and getting opinions from everybody who's in the enterprise.
What happened to the part about lowering expectations?
Well, I'm answering a direct question, so I'm comfortable with the Ferguson story. You know, journalism, as you know, Jack, is a very dynamic, unpredictable thing at its best, and fun at its best. And so I'm not saying, you know, I don't want to make light of criminal justice reporting, but it is fun. I did it for 15 years in my 20s and 30s. The joy of discovery is really something about journalism that you rarely get in any other area that I'm familiar with. And so, anyway, we're going to also have fun and be creative and you know, hopefully do things well.
Will you send somebody to Ferguson?
Let's see. We have a couple of things in mind that we can do without sending somebody to Ferguson. I mean, we've sent already half a dozen reporters to half a dozen states on different stories. So it's not, we have a budget for travel and our, you know, policy is one that will be very familiar to you from your days at the New York Times, which is go. But, you know, you You only want, you don't want to send a reporter down to join the throng of reporters in the street
right.
responding to whatever the public reaction is. It's got, you got to have a,
getting arrested.
Yeah, you. We might be better off than most news organizations if somebody got arrested, because at least we get an inside story out of it.
Right. on that point, the product of the Marshall Project, you've spoken about big, long investigative takeout pieces. Will you do instant reporting?
Yes, we'll do instant reporting, but only, you know, again, we're not going to try to be, you know, replicating the wire service and the other news organizations that do think, do the sort of standard issue reaction. We will have, in addition to investigative projects and shorter original reporting, a daily newsletter that Andrew Cohen, who used to work at The Atlantic and CBS, is preparing for us, which will be a roundup of the most interesting news and opinion on criminal justice
daily
of that day,
like.
And it'll go out to, I hope, a rather large email audience, delivered with considerable authority and a bit of attitude.
So we can subscribe.
You can subscribe. It's free.
If I may, www.marshallproject.org.
Good.
And that will allow people to get our email, our daily email, our Twitter feed, our Facebook, you could like.
And when you have a big takeout, it'll appear.
It'll appear on our website.
And on the website, yeah. The website, that's where the website is, and that will direct you to any. There are infinite numbers of ways to receive our wisdom.
Good. Great. Let's turn to the larger question of online media in general. Apart from the challenge of starting a nonprofit internet news site, there have been a number of people who've done that already. What have you learned from the experience of, say, ProPublica, Huffington Post, Texas Tribune, the Voice of San Diego?
I'd say the most interesting thing I learned is that there's no template. You know, in most new industries, whether it was automobiles or PCs, you know, somebody comes up with a model and everybody rips it off and they all do it. The amazing thing about all the organizations you mentioned, not to mention dozens more, is that they're all different. Their business models are different, their approach to journalism is different. And so it's not like we can say we want to be like these guys, because there is just no template that's and also there's no template that's proven to be profitable, FYI. In fact, there's a lot of evidence that the so-called profitable online, you know, the digital news organizations, you know, have a ways to go. So we have met with many editors, and there's a certain generosity among all the other news organizations to share information. And we have learned a lot from everybody. But what I've learned is, like, A, it's hard. It's really hard. But also, it doesn't really work. You can't be in it like anybody else. It's not like, you know, there used to be, remember when there was the Village Voice, there was Alternative Weeklies, and there was the Real Paper, and the Boston Phoenix, and everybody just did the model. You can't do that now. So there's a lot of self-invention that's going on, and that to me is the most interesting. I can't think of a business that's like that, where there's just no two are really alike.
No, we're really in the let a thousand flowers bloom stage of journalism now. I think mostly for the good, but you know the places you mentioned are all kind of journalism in the public interest outlets. There are a lot of others that have a slightly different take. There are some that are polemical, like The Intercept, Glenn Greenwald's website, who has the advantage of having a multi-billionaire behind him. There are places that don't specialize in subject matter, but specialize in a way of looking at things, like 538, which looks at the world through the lens of data and statistics, or Vox, which looks at the world through the lens of analysis. You know, there are websites that are somewhat similar to us in that they attempt to do public service journalism. There are subject-specific places like Kaiser Health News. There's every kind of subject, every kind of business model, every kind of perspective or tone of voice can be found out there, and I have no idea which of them will survive. Although, I mean, one thing that makes you nervous stepping into this world is that there's this, these days, this kind of culture of snap judgment. you know, you you put up your new website and the media critics flock around, you know, like bees, and sting you for a few days, and you know, then you either recover from the stings or you don't.
So things like BuzzFeed are as far from ProPublica as you could be.
No.
But BuzzFeed is actually hiring reporters.
They have 150 reporters.
No kidding.
And yeah. Probably a dozen from the New York Times.
Huh. They do places great. Like Vice, which, you know, started out and still, to a large extent, is a kind of gonzo television style of journalism, had a reporter embed with ISIS. And, you know, the style, the presentation of the story is not, would not have found great approval at the New York Times, but it was actual journalism. Mm-hmm. So there are people not just experimenting with, you know, ways to get eyeballs, but to wade with ways to connect the eyeballs to serious stuff.
Well, one of the virtues, enduring virtues of the New York Times or the Washington Post or a few other papers is it's still one-stop shopping. Otherwise, do you have time to go look at 6 or 12 or 100 different news sites every day?
Well, I don't think most people read that way anymore. I mean, and most people don't necessarily read the Washington Post and New York Times in a one-stop way. They read it online. They read it through their Twitter feeds or their Facebook feeds. So my reading is exactly, I go through Twitter, people post articles, and I might, in fact, rather than have one-stop shopping, I may have 1,000 options of where what to read, and I can easily discern what I want to click through. And
okay, but take it out of the abstract.
What
did you read this morning?
Oh, I read the hard copy of the New York Times. I read the hard copy of the Wall Street Journal, which is not a daily event. I happened to read it today. And then from time to time, I would go on my computer and go through Twitter, and I don't even remember if they were from Politico or ProPublica or BuzzFeed or dozens of other places or a Middle Eastern site from somebody in Egypt I never heard of who posted it because I might be interested in Egypt. I mean, I find the richness, not always the quality, but the richness and diversity of news sources to be...
And the shallowness.
No. I think it... I'll take the trade-off for me. I think the immediacy, and there's a lot of smart reporting. It's not the same. I mean, I love what we're going to do, too, and I don't denigrate it in any way. But... listen, I have kids at 19 and 24. I don't think they read the New York Times paper every day, and I'm not even sure they read the New York Times online every day. They are so informed because there's so much going on when they're engaged in a lot of stuff that we may not, you know, endorse. So I'm not that pessimistic. I mean, I think the digital revolution is probably in the end is gonna lead to an increase in average intelligence, I would argue, and journalism literacy.
You know, if you put that question to the people who work for us, instead of to, you know, the old farts who run the place.
Thank you.
Or the old fart who edits the place. You know, they with a couple of exceptions, they are mostly under 35. They are digital natives. They follow the news on things like Feedly and RSS feeds and customized Twitter feeds. And they're pretty damn well informed and interesting to talk to. I mean, I share your slight suspicion that that the internet has created an ADD kind of approach to the world, and that, you know, and it's true that I see my own children kind of skating over the surface of a lot of stuff, but that's not necessarily the case. I mean, if you are curious, you can be well served. The digital age has blown up. I think the word we're supposed to use is disaggregated, the conventional newspaper where you got everything in one shop. Mm-hmm. But people are finding ways to re-aggregate their daily news consumption.
Is there a Reader's Digest of the web inside?
Yeah, it's Google. No, I mean, there's all these aggregate, Google and Huffington Post and Yahoo News, and there's 10 or 12 sites that are do just that, and people can peruse them. And mm-hmm. The only thing you can really rely on is going to change. You know, I mean, 5 years ago, Facebook was an emerging social media network of people who could link with their friends, and today it is the number one publisher of news. And there's a whole hegemony going on because Facebook controls so many people
who have chosen to read their news through Facebook. It's bad for the publishers. It may be good for consumers. I don't really have an opinion. I know, just know that, like, 5 years ago, no one was saying this was going to happen. 2 years ago, no one knew this would happen. So, you know, what I think we're going to do is produce great journalism and be creative and have, we have a great staff of, as Bill suggested, digital savvy editors who will make sure that our stuff gets where it has to go. But I can't tell you where that's going to be in a year.
You know, I still, I guess, think of myself as a foreign correspondent, and I love foreign news above all, and was foreign editor for a few years. And when I was foreign editor, I used to give the same speech that all foreign editors gave in the sort of mid-90s, which is lamenting the number of newspapers that used to have foreign bureaus and don't anymore. Mm-hmm. You know, why doesn't the Baltimore Sun have a, you know, Beijing bureau anymore? And forgive me if the Baltimore Sun still has a Beijing bureau, but they don't have as many bureaus as they right. used to have, and a lot of papers that had, you know, a dozen have none now.
Right.
I've actually come not 180 degrees, but maybe 90 degrees off of that point of view, because the reality is, for me as a consumer of foreign news, this is the golden age. Yes, there are not five different American newspapers that have correspondents in Buenos Aires that I read, but I can go online and read every correspondent who writes in the English language from Buenos Aires or whatever country I'm interested in. So I can read, you know, the FT, I can read the BBC, I can read the New York Times, I can read the Wall Street Journal, I can read Bloomberg from all these places. Plus, I can read, in the places that I still maintain an interest in, I can read the Russian news online, the good stuff and the really, 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 really bad stuff. I can read websites from South Africa and do. So for me, it's an embarrassment of riches.
So we're optimists.
Okay.
We're learning anyway.
Let me put you in the shoes of another publisher named Jeff Bezos. Now that he's made peace with Hachette,
mm-hmm.
what do you suppose he wants to do with the Washington Post?
Well, this is something, as you may not know, I'm the world's greatest expert on. I've given this a lot of thought. So it's funny you should ask. What is Jeff Bezos going to do? I do have a theory, though. I actually do. And, you know, a lot has been written about moguls like Pyramidia or Jeff Bezos getting into media and what are they doing. And I don't think it's proprietary to say Bill and I had conversations with Pyramidia and we discussed what we're doing, what they're doing. And this is months and months ago. And we got a sense of his own strategy, and I'm going to link him. He's the founder of eBay. Jeff Bezos is the founder of Amazon. I think what you're finding in media, and I would argue that Mark Andreessen is one of the founders of Netscape, who's invested in a lot of journalism, online journalism, too. I think you're not seeing a lot of moguls get into journalism in a sort of willy-nilly way. I think what Jeff Bezos is thinking, and I think what Pierre Omidyar is thinking, is we can apply the technology model to journalism. What's the technology model? The technology model is the customer comes first, profits can be deferred, and if you aggregate enough users and make yourself indispensable, like eBay did, you know, the viral effect of having more and more and more users increases the value of each incremental user. And like Amazon does, which still doesn't have profits, and you can make yourself essential, then you can figure out how to make money. I mean, they're commercial. I believe Jeff Bezos is commercially incented. And I even think Pierre Omidyar, although it's more complicated, is commercially incented. They cannot relate to, and you know, there's the experience that Bill alluded to at First Look, where Pierre Omidyar has had some turnover in his journalism organization. Journalists look at the world very differently from technologists. Technologists look at the customer. Journalists, a lot of times, we may look at other journalists, and what do we think, and who are we writing for? And it's a very different model. And so I think, I don't know, but I think what Bezos is saying is we have one of the preeminent brands in the country, in one of the most important cities, and probably the second most important city in the country, if I may. And we can build this and become indispensable to millions of people who care about politics, not just in D.C., and then apply the Amazon model. There it breaks down, because I don't know actually then, once they have that, how they charge and how he makes money. But I can almost guarantee you that Jeff Bezos bought the Washington Post for commercial reasons.
I can't say what they are, but I'm almost positive that he has a plan that has something to do with the way he built Amazon, which started with books, and if you remember, you know, that's my guess.
People I know at the Post are in pretty good spirits these days. I mean, Marty Baron, the editor of the Washington Post, has been given license to hire significant numbers of reporters after years of cutbacks. You know, they're not nearly as big as the New York Times newsroom, but they're growing. I happen to have been dealing with them lately because we're partnering on these stories. There is a little bounce in their step these days, a sense of confidence. You know, will it last? I don't know. Will they run into trouble when they write about Amazon? I don't know. They haven't yet, but you know, that we'll find out how thick-skinned right. Jeff Bezos is. But at least at the moment, I mean, one thing that is pretty clear from Bezos's record as an investor and an entrepreneur is that he goes for the long term. He doesn't go from right. quarter to quarter. And you know, I think that's helped inspire a sense mm-hmm. of optimism at the Post itself.
Bill, do you have any strong feelings about when you read that the Times was going to cut the newsroom staff by 100? When I read that story, my heart sank at first. But then I saw that the total number of people in the newsroom would still be 1,300.
Right.
It was 1,100 when I left.
Right. Well, during my 8 years as executive editor, we went through two rounds of staff cuts. One was entirely buyouts. We had a target of, it was about 100 that the first time. We got 100 voluntary buyouts. The second time it was also 100, and we didn't get the full 100, so we had to lay people off. I know from experience that it makes the place just miserable. And it's miserable because reporters are perfectly capable of keeping in their heads two contradictory thoughts. One of them is, I'm completely indispensable, and the other is, they're going to fire me. And people are, I can tell you without having set foot in the place for a while, that people are walking around the newsroom waiting to find out how many they're going to get through voluntary buyouts, you know, whether they should go back and read their last evaluation to see if they're likely to be on the hit list, if there's, and just the mood of a place during those times is tough. But you are right. I mean, the same thing happened on my watch. It was 1,250 when I took over in 2003, and it was 1,250 when I left in 2011.
They were
a different 1,250. I mean, a lot of kind of, I guess we refer to them as legacy journalists. A lot of the old timers, a lot of the veterans who, you know, grew up entirely in the print world, and who had enough years in for it to be worth their while to take the buyout, were gone. A lot of younger, newer journalists with digital skills had arrived, and they were needed. They built up an extraordinary interactive graphics department, which without which the Times website would not be nearly as successful as it is today.
Good. Let me share you with the audience and invite questions. Please identify, wait for the microphone to come around, and microphone is coming. Ma'am.
I was going to ask you how you like the newsroom on TV, but I'm not going to ask that. I was interested in you doing stories like you talked about the one on Todd Willingham, who was innocent, and a lot of people still refuse to believe that in Texas and so on. I'm guessing, tell me if I'm right or not, that part of your goal is to change public opinion on the death penalty. I take a class on politics with about 60 people, and whenever they've asked how many people support the death penalty, about a third of the hands go up here in Manhattan. How do you convince people? There have been case after case where reporting has shown somebody really was innocent, and yet I don't know if public opinion's changing.
Well, first of all, I love the newsroom, and I can testify that in newsrooms across America, everybody speaks in Aaron Sorkin dialogue all the time. Snappy repartee. There is never a dull sentence uttered in a newsroom in America. Our aim is not, I'm going to reframe your
premise. Our aim is not to convince people to turn against the death penalty. When we say we're non-ideological and impartial, we actually mean that. Our job is to present people with information, and if we, I mean, aside from the fact that that's what we're particularly good at, if we start preaching to people, then we end up preaching to the converted.
I don't mean preaching,
huh? Hmm?
But I don't mean preaching, but
right.
Evidence that sometimes people have
well, you know, we're,
for no good reason.
We're clearly going to write a lot about the death penalty. I mean, it's a newsworthy issue. A lot of states are beginning to have doubts about it. We have a story that's probably coming out in December, which I'm not going to tell you too much about, but it's about one major erosion of support for the death penalty. We will write about the whole controversy over lethal drugs. I mean, one thing that we can be partisan about as journalists is transparency. We are, you know, professionally, occupationally obliged to be in favor of disclosing information, especially information that about what the government does in your name. So, you know, I believe that the information about what chemicals are used in those lethal cocktails and where they come from and what the consequences of them are should be public information. And a lot of states are suing to keep it private. So we will write a lot about it, but the aim is not ultimately to, you know, create a groundswell of opinion against the death penalty. It's to let people decide for themselves.
That said, I would argue that the popularity of the death penalty has declined meaningfully in this country over the last several years. The incidence of actual executions have declined meaningfully. I believe that there are states like Oklahoma and Texas where you may find 80% of the people support the death penalty. I do think that the accumulation of botched executions, largely innocent or mostly innocent or probably provably innocent people who were executed, people who have been released on DNA, who are on death row, but for DNA discovery, I think the accumulation of everything has led to it's definitely led to a decline in the executions. And journalism has a huge role in that. So I wouldn't be as in despair as you sound. I think actually journalism is a major role player in exactly what we're talking about in the changing of public opinion about the death penalty.
Other questions?
Hi, I have a question for Mr. Keller. I was wondering, after so many years of working as a foreign correspondent, what led you to want to concentrate on the American criminal justice system?
Well, I spent the first sort of 25 years of my career swearing I would never be an editor of any kind, and I would rather stick pencils in my eyes than have a desk job and you know and lose the independence of being a reporter, especially a foreign correspondent, which is the best job anywhere. And then the then executive editor of the Times, Joe Lelyveld, who himself was a great foreign correspondent, asked me if I wanted to be the foreign editor of the New York Times. And it's one thing to say, I don't want to be an editor. It's another thing to say, I don't want to be the foreign editor of the New York Times. I mean, so I did. One of the weird things about journalism is that we take reporters who are contrarian, don't enjoy authority or don't live well with authority, who can be a little egotistical and wildly independent, and then we try to turn them into editors whose job is to be team players and disciplined and self-effacing, and it sometimes works really, really badly. I turned out to be reasonably good at it for reasons only my shrink can explain.
I knew every day.
it turned out that I liked it, actually. I like the collaborative nature of it. I like being a kind of mentor to younger reporters. I like watching people, you know, editing isn't just about making stories better, it's about making reporters better, and when you succeed at doing that, it's a real thrill. The criminal justice part of it is all his business. I mean, his doing. He
I had one of the sweetest jobs in journalism, writing an op-ed column for the Times for a couple of years. And Neil came along and said, you know, let's put on a play. And at the time, I had this column. So I said, but you know, I haven't really thought that deeply about criminal justice. Maybe I'll write a column about it, and then I'll learn something. And then I wrote another column about it, and I found it just deeply engrossing. I found that the Pentagon has this phrase, a target-rich environment. For journalists, the criminal justice system is a target-rich environment. There's just endless great and appalling stories to be written. I found I really liked the company of the people who worry about those issues. And I found, maybe this is overly optimistic, but that unlike almost every other policy area in Washington these days where there's total gridlock and animosity, in criminal justice, there's actually the beginnings of a common ground between right and left. I don't mean to exaggerate that. There are a lot of areas where they disagree still, but on things like sentencing reform, for example, on the idea that having 2.2 million people in prison is too many, you've now got, you know, Rand Paul and Cory Booker co-sponsoring legislation. You've got the Koch brothers giving money for indigent defense. So there's, you know, this actually felt like an area, I'll shut up after this. My daughter always tells me that I need to give shorter answers. This really felt like an area where if we went and applied ourselves, we might move the conventional wisdom a little bit.
Sir, here she comes.
In terms of sponsoring investigations or journalism, you almost said it, the economics of the criminal justice system really needs to be studied and analyzed across the board, because it is what is motivating a great deal of the change that you've referred to. Mm-hmm. The other aspect, I think, is what are your plans about capturing the voices of people who are in prison or otherwise impacted by the system, in their own words?
Boy, am I glad you asked that. I can give away one thing that we're going to have that nobody can copy. We have a researcher who has been meticulously going around to writing programs. There are a lot of writing programs in prison, looking specifically for inmates who can write. We're not particularly dying to, you know, print inmate poetry or fiction, or you know, long self-serving accounts of how they were actually screwed by the criminal justice system. But what it's like to live inside. The first of those will be published, I can't remember, Sunday or Monday this week, from a man in Attica who writes quite beautifully. And the first piece of what I hope will be quite a few that he'll write for us is about a fellow inmate who's dying of cancer in Attica. I find it very moving. And so we would like to do a lot of that. Those are voices that, you know, you don't have to approve of the crimes they committed to want to hear in their own voice what the experience is like. I forgot what the first part of your question was.
The economics of
criminal justice and incarceration. Yeah, we have three stories I can think of already in the works on various aspects of, it's not just private prisons, which private prisons hold about 7% of the prisoners in the U.S., although that number is growing a bit because the federal government is throwing immigration, undocumented immigrants into private prisons. But it's also private health care, private transportation services, private phones, private parole, private halfway houses. All of these are kind of growing industries, and they are not enthusiastic about the idea of reducing prison populations.
Your last answer reminded me that there are a lot of communities that are reliant on jobs in the criminal system, and strongly advocate against disbanding or minimizing the criminal justice system, what kind of work would you want to do there?
That's very true. It's you know, upstate New York is a whole archipelago of communities where the local industry is the prison, and the strongest defenders of the prison are the state assemblymen and state senators who represent those districts, and the guard unions, and they have considerable clout. It's very hard to close a prison in New York State, and we have one story I'm not going to be too specific about in the works on that subject. I mean, there are other states that have managed to close prisons. Texas is, has, of all places, has managed to close three or four prisons in the last couple of years. So it can be done, and we want to also, we want to look at places that have done it to try to explore how they did it.
Neil, listening to all this and watching all these reporters doing what so interests you, do you miss not writing?
Yes and no. I mean, you know, I write a little, you know, here and there in any case, but I really feel I have the best position. You know, I feel you kind of have to be all in a news organization or not in. And if you're all in, you're all in, and I don't miss that. Uh-huh. I like what I'm doing. I like, and, you know, we're a small office, we discuss things, and I'm, you know, I have input to the extent that anyone wants to listen to me, but no one has to listen to me because and so I'm reminded of from time to time. So, no, I think...
That's the kind of publisher I like to hear.
Well, you know, the reality is I exaggerate my sense of nirvana a little bit. I respect I'm mindful that in order to have the kind of news organization we need, people need to have jobs and people need to have roles. And I'm really thrilled with my role. I like being the chairman, I like interacting, I like building a board, I like talking strategy and having created this whole enterprise, and to not need to, or not to work on the day-to-day journalism or be writing or editing. If I could do that for 2 weeks out of a month, that would be awesome, but that's not the way the world is. You know, we have people doing this and you get resented, you know, you know, we have reporters and editors working 24/7 and they really don't want to get criticism from somebody who may seem like a dilettante because he comes in and out. So the structure's the structure. I mean, I would certainly tweak it.
Okay.
I would not, I'm not claiming at all that I don't want to engage, and I do engage, and we do engage, and we do argue, I mean, and debate, and we don't agree about everything. But, and there's gray areas, and I'm not trying to make it seem like it's a Garden of Eden of cooperation. But it pretty much is, actually, because I think at the end of the day, I understand that for this to work, I've gotten to know Bill. You know, Bill loves journalism. I know what Bill likes. He loves reporting. He likes working with editors and young writers. And that's what motivates Bill. And it's important for me that Bill be motivated and happy. Now, that's not actually what motivates me. Other things motivate me. Creating this, knowing that getting a pride of authorship is big. Seeing our stories over time have impact, which I'm sure they will. And that will fill me with great pride and sense of achievement, even if I hadn't written them or edited them. So, you know, I won't say the answer. The real answer to your question is a little.
Okay?
It's a process. But on the other hand, there are so many offsetting pleasures and senses of accomplishment and achievement I can have from what I'm doing that I think it does work better this way. But no, from time to time, sure, I would love to be king for a day, of course.
Good. Jack McKenzie, here comes the mic.
Back to the death penalty. You mentioned the arguably innocent, and I don't know whether you said proven innocent.
Yes.
I'm looking for the story of the unarguably innocent who have been executed. Have we got it? And are you going to get it if you don't have it?
To my knowledge, okay. This is actually overdue. Part of the conversation. I, and I don't think Bill puts himself out as the world's greatest expert on criminal justice, right? We're still learning, and so I may give you an incomplete answer, okay? And there may be people in this room who could even give you a better answer. But to my knowledge, there are two cases. One is the Todd Willingham case, where there's basically no evidence remaining that would convict him, as far as I know, but I'll leave that to Bill. There's another case that was in Texas in the early 90s, and it was the subject of a book, The Two Carloses, where there was an actual murder, a conviction, an execution of a young woman in a gas station. I don't remember the town. And there was the guy that was executed, his name was Carlos. There was somebody else named Carlos who was a police informant who had a criminal record a mile long. And there was a Columbia law professor who put his students on cases to look into it, and they delved in, and they actually found the other Carlos. There's a book, The Other Carlos. There's a documentary being made about this. And I believe, and Andrew Cohn, who's our colleague, who's covered this a lot longer, would say that case, even more than the Todd Willingham case, where you don't have a murderer in Todd Willingham, you may not have had a murder, but here you actually have a murderer and an executed person, and they're not the same person, that is considered the most definitive case of an innocent person being executed in America, to my knowledge. And I am saying, this may be an incomplete answer, but to my knowledge, that's the most definitive case out there.
I'm quite comfortable just objectively saying that, certainly in the case of Todd Willingham, that he was not convicted beyond a reasonable doubt. They did not have a case is he inarguably innocent? I don't really know what happened in that room, in that house, when it went up in flames. I'm inclined to think that the forensics guys who came in after the fact and said they thought it was an accident are right. But we're still waiting for that case where the legal system posthumously exonerates somebody, and there's an effort underway in both of those cases to get a posthumous exoneration.
And you're on it.
We're on it.
What about the innocence part?
Well,
ma'am, behind you, Jack.
Sorry.
Thank you. I wasn't completely clear about your distribution strategy. You said you have some distribution with Slate and the Washington Post. Are all of your stories going to be third-party distributed?
No. Well, our main form of distribution will be our website and social media, which we will use. We'll stick our tentacles out into the ether and draw you in and confront you with all this great journalism. But we will also partner with people in some cases exclusively. These pieces with the Washington Post required a pretty close collaboration on the editing and the lawyering and so on. So they get an exclusive use of the pieces that we're running. In other cases, we'll do it on a non-exclusive basis, basically as, you know, hoping that many people will pick up a story and use it. I mean, we're not selling these stories, at least at this point. We're aiming for the maximum exposure. So, if we can find, I mean, Neil's dream is that, you know, one morning we'll have 25 newspapers across the country all with the same story on their front pages, and it's a Marshall Project story. And that's not an outlandish proposition. It's slightly restrained by the prospect of having to deal with 25 papers, copy desks, and legal departments before they publish.
Which is why I don't totally miss being a hands-on journalist.
We do two more questions. There's one.
Is there an effort to employ more women and minorities, especially considering race relations in the criminal justice system?
Yeah. I mean, that's the first conversation that Neil and I had. We both agreed that, you know, it was important to try for a diverse staff. Women has not proven to be difficult at all. Of our 8 reporters, 6 are women. Finding minorities is more difficult. Minorities are underrepresented in a lot of things, including investigative reporting. But 2 of our 8 reporters are African American. One of them, who's just about to join us, a guy named Corey Johnson, who's been working for the Center for Investigative Reporting in California,
did a quite impressive investigation of involuntary sterilizations in women's prisons in California, that enlightened state of my birth. And he, as a result of which, the legislature changed the law. So he'll be coming to join us.
Way in the back.
Hi, I was just curious if you're going to plan on having any video content or anything other than written content, and if so, would you create it in-house, or would it be something where you'd create it like, you know, the New York Times op docs or something like that?
We will have lots of content that is not words. We have a couple of people on board who are very skilled at interactive graphics, maps. Gabe Dance, who's the managing editor, who's oversees the digital journalism, used to work at the New York Times and then at the Guardian. It's even threatening that at some point we'll come up with some games. He managed to use games a couple of times when we were both at the Times to tell stories. Video is a bit of a different matter because it's to do it well and to do it abundantly is quite expensive. And, you know, we're doing well in the fundraising, but that would have eaten quite a large hunk of our budget. So we will certainly link to video. We have the capacity to run video. And I hope that, you know, if we're successful and we raise the money, we'll eventually do some original video content, but not at the outset.
Let me invite you all to join me in two things. The first is, as we leave, there's a reception upstairs in the Four Freedoms Room, and we'd love for you to join us. The second is to thank and to toast our speakers for a splendid evening. Thank you very much indeed.